Yes, I like to think that I've always respected ants, but that level of respect has definitely increased throughout the making of the movie. It's important to note also that no ants were harmed during the making of the movie in any way. Let's get that out of the way.
Until now.
Until now, until this actual press conference.
But it's not when we were making a movie, so it doesn't count.
It's true.
I think it's fair to say that none of us would be here, and there might not even be an Ant-Man movie if it weren't for Edgar and Joe, and that should absolutely go said. You know, the idea to make Ant-Man a heist movie structure was all Edgar and Joe. The idea of Hank Pym and Scott Lang as mentor and pupil, again, that was all theirs. And also the idea of a movie that all drives toward a third act where the big battle between the good guy and the bad guy takes place in a little girl's bedroom. That was always there from the beginning, and I stand by the fact that I think that's genius. I love it. When I came on, I really came on at the same time that Adam and Paul were starting to do rewrites on the draft. And really, it was sort of taking what existed. Adam and I bonded over the fact that we were both kids who grew up reading those comics. I probably untold hours alone in my bedroom reading comic books. And same for Adam. So there were some elements that had been in the comics that had not made their way into the script that we wanted to bring to it. And then I think we also wanted to sort of take that heist motif, add more sort of the heist movie language in terms of the visual language of the movie. And then also it wasn't lost on me that, you know, Hank Pym in the comics is such a complicated character. And we had a very complicated man playing that character. We had Michael, who, you know, has made an amazing career out of playing, you know, characters, I think it's fair to say, with a lot of gray area, and that we wanted
what
to
is that?
Really... and really, it was, you know, to sort of just deepen that character, and the idea that always appealed to me from the beginning, that at the center of this movie are two fathers and two daughters, and that there was a lot of sort of emotionality to be mined from that. So, you know, Adam and Paul worked incredibly hard in doing the rewrites. And then when we were in production, Paul continued to work with our production writers, Andrew Bearer and Gabe Ferrari. So it really was an evolution. But, you know, I have to say, I really think the spirit of what Edgar and Joe created from the beginning is still very much a part of the DNA of the movie. Sorry, Paul, I didn't leave much for you to say.
No, I think you covered it all.
I don't know if this signals a trend in Marvel. I think they've always done these sort of subgenres, and I think that's one of the things that keeps the Marvel movies so interesting. I mean, when you look at last year, Captain America Winter Soldier owes to sort of a 70s political thriller, like a paranoia thriller, and Guardians of the Galaxy, which came out the same year, is this crazy gonzo space opera. And our movie happens to have the structure and feel of a heist movie, and I think that's one of the things Marvel's really done is, you know, sometimes you'll talk to Kevin Feige, it's like, well, we don't make superhero movies, we make genre movies. And I think it's been a very smart thing. In terms of the second thing, I was always, in terms of the comics, I always loved the original Hank Pym, you know, right around, you know, 62 on up, the original Avengers comics. I love the relationship between Hank and Janet, the fact that they were an amazing superhero duo, but also the romance between those two characters was always fascinating. And then also the fact that Hank Pym, there's a little bit of schizophrenia and maybe a little bit of, he had an inferiority complex, because in the Avengers, he was fighting alongside Thor and Hulk, and he always felt inadequate. And as we know in the comics, he changed his identity a lot, and I always found that fascinating. So those early years to me were great. I'm hoping that audiences will respond to this movie, and if we're fortunate enough to be able to make another Ant-Man movie, I think there's a lot of story left to tell with these characters, and I think there's also a freedom at Marvel to kind of tonally do whatever we think is best, what serves the story best. So this one happens to be a highly comedic heist movie in terms of its structure and tone. I think there's a portion of Ant-Man that will always have a comedic component to it, but I like the idea that we could, you know, and invent an entirely different feel for a sequel if we're fortunate enough to be able to do one. I think we get to the end of this movie, and there are a lot of questions at the end of the movie about what may or may not happen with these characters. I mean, in terms of Scott Lang, he's become Ant-Man for the purposes of this heist, but what next, you know? There are definitely some hints in the movie, and we also know that Paul is going to appear as Scott Lang in Captain America Civil War, which is very exciting. I'll speak for Evangeline, who's not here, but, you know, Hope's arc in this movie is every bit as important as Scott's. I mean, she really, in this movie, and particularly at the end of the movie, she's going to finally have her chance to be a hero as well, and I think it's exciting to imagine what might happen with her. And as far as Hank Pym, you know, the things that happen in this movie, he had been obsessed in the past with exploring the quantum realm and trying to figure out if he could save his wife and wasn't able to. But there are things that happen at the end of the movie that might reignite that obsession. And it remains to be seen if that's a good thing or a bad thing. Who knows?
But I think it's a good thing.